In this lesson, we'll take a look at incorporating the Corona SDK physics engine into our projects. The Corona SDK physics engine incorporates the well-known Box2D physics engine in order to allow the addition of physics to any display object. Let's get started. I've already coded a ball to appear on the screen using Display New Image Rect. To get started with physics, let's add some physics to the ball so that it drops from its starting location and bounces upon hitting the bottom of the display. First, we'll need to instantiate the physics engine by incorporating the following lines into our code. Local physics equals require physics. This loads the physics module into our Corona project and assigns it to the physics variable. physics.start. This tells the physics engine to begin. You should not add any other physics directives until this line is called. Second, we'll need to add a body to our ball. Bodies are the primary means for adding physics properties to our display objects. To add a physics body to our ball, we'll write the following code. Physics add body. Open and close our parentheses. Now the name of the object to add the body to, ball, comma, and then additional properties to load at the instantiation. So we'll open and close curly braces and we'll type density equals 0.3, friction equals 0.6, and radius equals 50. Now you can sort of intuit as to what these properties will mean, the density of the object, the friction of the object, and because it's a ball, we need to define a radius in terms of pixels. And remember that radius is half of the diameter, and the diameter of the ball is 100. Okay, so let's take a look at the results. We'll go back to the simulator and relaunch. So the ball drops and then heads through the bottom of the display and is actually still dropping as we speak. So we need to add a floor for the physics ball to react against. So let's add that. Local floor equals display.newRect. We'll just use a rectangle, draw it on the fly. Open and close the parentheses. The top and left, we're going to position this after we create it, so we'll just set those to 0. The width of the rectangle, which is going to be the display width, and the height of the rectangle, which will be 20 pixels. Okay, so now let's set the reference point. So floor, set reference point, and we'll set it to the center, display.center reference point. And when you're using physics bodies, it's important to actually set the reference point to the center, especially if you're going to use any rotation, because if you don't do that, you can get some weird results with the body added to the display object. So let's position the x and y, floor dot x equals half of the width, and floor dot y is 420. We're going to set it a little bit above the bottom of the display so that we can see it. Okay, let's take a look at it in the simulator. And the ball drops and heads straight through the floor. That's because we need to add a physics body to the floor. So now, just as we did with the ball, physics.addBody, and open and close our parentheses, the name of the display object to add the body to, that's floor, comma. Now we're going to use a second argument, which is an optional argument that denotes the body type. The default body type is called dynamic. With a dynamic body type, the object is susceptible to all aspects of physics. We're going to use the static body type. Static here is used for objects that act as platforms, walls, or boundaries, and can be reacted against, but themselves are not changed. A third designation is kinematic, and those are objects not affected by gravity. We won't be using that in this particular lesson. Okay, let's type comma, and open and close curly braces, and let's create some properties for the floor. So we'll do friction equals 0.3 and bounce equals 0.4. Save it and let's take a look. And there we see the ball has finally bounced against the floor and reacted. Let's see what happens if we apply a subtle amount of rotation to the floor. We'll go back to the code, and underneath floor, we'll type floor.rotation equals 1.5. So this will rotate the floor 1.5 degrees clockwise. Save it, head to the simulator, and relaunch. So now that you see the floor is sloped, the ball will move in the direction of the slope, pointed down towards gravity. You can see at the end, the ball fell off the floor and now is traveling downwards. What we need to do is add walls on the left and right side of the display, much in the same way that we added a floor. We'll add two rectangles that are positioned slightly off screen, and the ball, upon hitting those rectangles, will stop, as those rectangles will have static physics bodies. Let's add them. For the sake of time, I've already created the code for the walls in another script. I'll copy the code and paste it into our current code. This code creates two walls that are two rectangles, one positioned at the left of the display and the other positioned at the right. Now let's add physics bodies to these walls. Physics, add body, left wall, static, and then the same properties as the floor. Friction equals 0.3 and bounce equals 0.4. We'll copy this line of code, paste it, and change the object to right wall. We'll save it, head back to the simulator, and take a look. And now we see that the ball has stopped against the right wall, which we can't really see, but it's right at the edge of the display. If you're curious as to what the physics engine sees in terms of the physics bodies and their boundaries, you can set the draw mode of the physics engine by doing the following. We'll head to the line right below physics.start and add physics.setDrawMode, and as a string, we'll type debug. Okay, we'll save it and render. Now you see the bodies and not the display objects. The left wall is present, it's just off screen. Okay, we'll head back to the code and now we'll change it to hybrid. You see both the bodies and the display objects. We'll keep it in this mode for the remainder of the lesson. While we have seen the effect of physics on making an object with a dynamic body fall with gravity and react against an object with a static body, it would be helpful if we could implement some sort of code that would give feedback to the user upon collision of the ball with the floor or the walls. Let's have a sound playback with every bounce of the ball. We'll head back to the code, and we'll add below the physics lines, local boing equals audio.loadSound, media boing.AIFF. This is a sound that's contained within a media folder in my Corona project. Now we'll add a runtime event listener that listens for collisions between physics bodies. We'll head to the bottom of the code and type runtime colon add event listener, and we'll listen for the collision event and call the method onHit. That method is to be created. By now, this should be old hat. We're basically telling the system to listen for the collision event. The system here is represented by runtime. Before we create the onHit method, Let's add unique identifiers to our ball in the form of a name property. We'll head back up to where the ball code is, and underneath type ball.name equals and a string ball. This will prove helpful in a minute. Now we'll apply the following logic to our onHit function. Function onHit e end. If e.phase double equals began, then end. If e.object1 dot body type equals static, then end. And what we want to do is, if the object collides against a body type that is static, play the boing sound. Audio dot play, and in parentheses, boing. Okay, let's take a look. We'll relaunch. And there we get the boing. And we should also get the boing upon hitting the wall. Now we're going to change the bounce of the wall so that there's no bounce at all. So that way when the ball hits the wall, it comes to a dead stop. So let's head back to the left wall and right wall physics body code and set the bounce equal to 0. Let's save it and relaunch. Okay, we get our bounce sounds, and then we still get a boing, but the visual feedback is such that it doesn't really seem like we should have the boing sound when the ball is not actually bouncing. So let's fix this by adding some additional logic to our code. First, we'll add unique identifiers to the walls to identify them as walls. So let's head to left wall and right wall, and underneath the instantiation code, type left wall dot type equals wall. We'll do the same for the right wall. Right wall dot type equals wall. Now we'll alter our logic by doing the following. If e dot object one dot body type double equals static, and e.object1.type does not equal wall, then play the boing sound. We'll save it and relaunch. So you can see that the ball has hit the floor, the boing sound happens, and then when it hits the wall, there is no more boing sound. Of course, this is a really simple implementation of physics, only consisting of a single dynamic object, the ball, and multiple static objects. As you were to implement it in your game, probably this type of logic is a little too simple to scaffold out to a full game, but it gives you an idea of how you can start. The world of physics implementations within games is pretty vast and complex, and we really only scratch the surface as to what is possible. In future lessons, we'll take a look at how to implement the physics engine in order to more easily test for collisions and create interactions between objects when they hit each other according to various conditions.